Shit, stop splashing me. Damn. Damn, girl, go bother Jimmy Smith. His little perverted ass probably chilling in his tub right now waiting for you. Why you gotta bother me when I'm trying to record this thing? Damn. You got time for this right now? Shit. Sorry, guys, trying to record this new segment of Ciccarelli's Corner here on alchemistradio.com, but I've got the Bellator girls, Jade Bryce and Mercedes Terrell, trying to freaking throw me into this hot tub with them, all splashing me and shit, and hey, put the rubber ducky away. Put the rubber ducky away. It ain't supposed to be used like that. Shit, that was a gift. God damn it. But anyway, speaking of Bellator, last week Bellator debuted its first reality series, Fight Master, on Spike TV, and I want to talk about that more in depth because we spoke a little bit about it last week on the show. We actually had Tim Welsh, one of the fighters on the show, come on with us last week, but we didn't really go too in depth. So I wanted to give my full review, my full thoughts on how I thought Bellator did, on their debut, and what we can expect as the show progresses. So right away, when this show was announced a couple months ago, when Bellator made news that they were going to kind of dip their seed into the reality show, reality series thing, I think the biggest concern was that it was going to be a rip-off of the UFC's Ultimate Fighter show that we've seen on Spike for many years, and now, of course, on FX and, Fox Sports 1 now. That was the big concern. I mean, even Dana White said that when he was asked about it in one of his media scrums. He's like, it's just going to be another tough rip-off. But when they brought forward the format of the show, you knew it was going to be different. You knew it was going to be something, some kind of an alternative, because with the Ultimate Fighter, you have two coaches of the same weight class coaching against each other. They pick their teams, they pick the matchups, and at the end of the show, they fight each other. Bellator's Fight Master is different. You have four coaches instead of two, and the fighters themselves control their destiny. They're picking their coach, they're picking who they're going to fight, so it's not going to be the same as Tough. And like I said, with Tough, you have the two coaches that fight each other at the end. That's something that can't happen with Fight Master, because all of the coaches are either retired or they're not in the same weight class, or in Greg Jackson's case, he's a full-time MMA coach, not a professional fighter. So you're really not going to see them fight at the end unless a brawl breaks loose on the show. You never know. Maybe Joe Warren throws a shoe at Frank Shamrock's head and he freaking flips out, and the two of them start brawling, and then Randy and Greg start going at it, freaking throwing bombs. You never know with reality TV. Anything can happen. But my line of thinking was, okay, this is cool. This is something different. It's going to be more about the fighters, more about the tournament, and less about the drama between the coaches. That's what I thought. That was my thinking process even before the show aired. But if episode one was any indication of how the rest of the series is going to play out, and I might be wrong about there not being a whole lot of focus on the coaches. But we'll get into that in a little bit. I wanted to break things down from start to finish. So at the start of the show, the four coaches start talking. They do their little interview segment. They talk about why they're here, what they're doing, and who they are. A little bit of a background on them for fans that aren't that familiar with them. What I thought was a little strange was, it's good. I mean, it's good that they're all competitive, and they're all in it to win it. They all want to have the team at the end that has the most wins. They want to have the fighter that wins the tournament, as he should. That should be the goal as the coach. But it seems like, and maybe it was just the editing, maybe it was just, they were so pumped up that they kind of didn't realize the way that they were saying things, but it seemed like these guys were just very much focused on their own reputation and less about, okay, I'm here to mentor some young guys. I'm here to mentor the next big thing for Bellator. It seemed like, especially Greg Jackson, which I thought was strange, because Greg Jackson is a great guy, phenomenal coach, one of those guys that really instills confidence and motivation into his team. But when he was talking, it was a different side of Greg Jackson that I don't know if I liked too much. And again, maybe it was the editing, and I'm sure it probably was, but he was kind of like, You know, I want people to know I'm the best mixed martial arts coach in the world, and this show is no different. And, you know, I need to make sure that I win, blah blah blah. And I don't know. To me, that was a little strange. It didn't seem like the Greg Jackson that we all have come to know. So, again, TV editing might have come into play with that one. But so after the coaches introduce themselves, they come in, they sit down, and what looked like some comfortable ass chairs, man. I mean, shit, I wish I had some chairs that comfortable in my office. You know, I'd probably be falling asleep every day at work. You know, I kind of have to envy them. You know, if you're a tough coach, like if you're coaching on the Ultimate Fighter and you're sitting on those, you know, metal chairs, and then you're watching Bellator, they got like freaking chairs fit for kings. And if I was Ronda Rousey or Miesha Tate, I'd be going up to Dana right now and being like, "Hey man, listen, you got to get some better furniture. I mean, shit, you have a better budget than Bellator, and look what they're pumping out. They probably spent like $100 on those chairs, maybe two, three. You know, you never know." But so they sit down, the fights to get into the house start coming in, and the first fight is between, of course, Tim Welsh, the Ginger Ninja, and Chip Pollard. At right away. You know, these guys start fighting, and you hear the coaches kind of giving their commentary, and really, really obvious commentary too. Again, with Greg Jackson, I don't know if it was like the producers just telling him, okay, you know, just say whatever comes to mind, just start, you know, saying technical things, and I guess, you know, just Greg just saying stuff that's really kind of obvious. He's like, oh, you know, it's really important when you're throwing a strike to back out and exit so you don't get hit. You don't hit, get hit back. And I'm sitting there going, well, no shit. I didn't, you know, I never would have known that, Greg. Wow. Thanks for the insightful advice there. But no, I don't really know what was going on there. But fight starts. Tim Welsh knocks out Chip Pollard, round one. Looked very impressive, showcased his power, and, you know, blew the coaches away. They were all kind of fighting over this kid and who they were going to. You know, who was going to have him? You know, you could tell right away they all were interested. So Tim comes back. He's given the opportunity to ask the coaches questions. You know, kind of see who would be the right fit for him. And he ultimately decides on going with Greg Jackson, which is an excellent choice. I mean, if I was a fighter on this show, I would be picking Greg Jackson too because he is the real coach here. I mean, not that the rest of them don't have a lot to offer because they, you know, they're coaches as well. But Greg is the guy that full time, every single day, is coaching elite mixed martial arts fighters and champions in the sport. So why not, you know, if you have an opportunity, pick this guy's brain. But like I said, we had Tim Welch on the show on Thursday, and we asked him ultimately why did you decide on Greg Jackson, and he said he had Jackson picked long before he even stepped foot on the filming, you know, to film the show. It was actually he's good friends with Joe Riggs, who's also on the show, and we'll see next week if Joe Riggs made it into the house. I'd be very surprised if he didn't, because he's got more experience than every single fighter on this show, and I'd be very, very, very surprised if Joe Riggs does not win his fight to get into the house. But he said him and Joe decided they were going to pick Greg Jackson, so. If obviously, once Joe Riggs fights and wins, he'll pick Greg Jackson as well. So Greg Jackson was very excited. He's like, you know, I'm looking forward to, you know, working with the end. We think you have a lot of potential. You know, one thing I gotta say though, and I said this on the show, you know, I was impressed with Tim Welsh not because of the knockout. Yeah, the knockout was cool, knocked the dude out. But this dude walks around calling himself the Ginger Ninja. I mean, that's some balls, man. You know, I mean, hell, I wouldn't give him shit about it. He'd probably knock my head off my shoulders. But you know, like I'm thinking the whole time, like while I'm watching this kid fight, like remember that guy on YouTube, that ginger kid that was, you know, he made all those videos. He's like, "Gingers do have souls." I bet you that guy probably freaking creamed his pants watching Tim Welch fight. Probably jumped up off his fat ass and did a cartwheel. Probably, you know, fell through his TV screen head first because he didn't complete the cartwheel all the way. Lost his balance because he's like 300 pounds. But that kid probably flipped his shit watching Tim Welch, you know, win his fight. So obviously he's got a fan there. But Tim's cool though. Tim's a great guy, and I'm looking forward to seeing him progress as the show moves forward. I think he's definitely a guy that you look at his record, it's not all that impressive. I think it's like 9-4, but he's a young kid, 22, and he's fought a lot of tough guys, and I think he's coming into his own, and maybe working with Greg Jackson will bring out the best of him. So next fight was between Eric Scanlon and Chris Curtis. Not the best fight in the world. Before the fight even aired, they did their little pre-interview package, and Scanlon's talking about how mixed martial arts saved his life from drugs. Without mixed martial arts, he'd be probably in jail and this and that. So obviously, this is a guy that's very passionate about the sport. Fight starts, and Scanlon throws a cheap shot leg kick, like obvious cheap shot leg kick, and I think the coaches, that kind of rubbed them all the wrong way. They were all kind of rooting for Curtis to knock him out, and Curtis went after him, dropped him. But Curtis has some terrible takedown defense, and that was really the problem. I mean, I think Scanlon stole the first round with some sloppy takedowns and a little bit of ground control, but Curtis was more aggressive, but he just was getting taken down way too easily. Same thing with the second round, except Scanlon was even more effective in that round and pretty much just controlled him, got the decision win. Didn't look that impressive, but again, this is the show where you're gonna see some guys that are green. That's the whole point of the show, is to coach them and bring out the best in them. So as a coach on the show, you should be thinking, you know what? That guy, he's green, he's not very good, but I can help him. Bring him on my team, let my assistant coaches and myself work with him. We'll get him better. We'll get him to the point where he needs to be. That wasn't the case. All four of the coaches really were not interested in this guy at all. I mean, Joe Warren was probably nicer than the rest of them, and that's why ultimately Scanlon decided on picking Joe Warren as his coach. But even Joe Warren was like, just you weren't that great, your wrestling needs a lot of work, blah blah blah, which is honest. But everybody else was just like, Greg Jackson was just like, yeah, I don't think I can help you too much. I think Randy and Joe would be a better fit for you for your wrestling. And it's like, come on, Greg, I just didn't get that. Telling the kid that I have nothing to offer you, I don't know. It was weird. But and then you had Randy, who told him, just kind of nonchalant, like, yeah, you need a lot of work. But Frank Shamrock was really the biggest, and I love Frank Shamrock. He's an awesome guy. We've had him on the show many times. I think he's often misunderstood. A lot of people don't get Frank Shamrock, but I do. I think he's a great guy. But he came across kind of douchey here. He's like, are you afraid to get hit? Like, are you afraid to get hit? And it's like, he's like, oh, I didn't like the way he was running away from shots and this and that. It's like, I don't think he was running away from shots. He was trying to win the fight. He won it on control. He took the guy down, did what he had to do to win. I mean, why would he take the most amount of damage in an elimination fight when you have at least a couple more fights left on the show if you want to win the tournament? Wouldn't it be smart to take the least amount of damage possible? And then Frank's like, on a scale of 1 to 10, how good are you? I mean, we're all 10s up here. Where do you think you are? And the kid's like, oh, I'm, about a 5. I have a lot of work that I need to do. And Frank's just looking at him like, I want nothing to do with you. You suck. Get away from me. And again, it could have just been for the show to build some more suspense and make it more interesting. I get that. I mean, like I said, I don't think Frank Shamrock was blatantly being a douche. I just think he was coming across kind of douchey. That's my opinion. But I like Frank Shamrock, so not hating on him there. But ultimately, Scanlon picks Joe Warren's team, and Joe Warren gets a fighter on the board. And Joe is not really that happy. He says it in his little, off the air interview that he thinks Eric is not a good fit for his team. But again, this just could be to build more suspense for the show. So next fight, Nick Phoenix Barnes gets a submission win over Brandon Tierney. This was the best fight on the card, or on the show, I should say. But this is a back and forth battle. I mean, Tierney had had Barnes in a couple tight submissions. Barnes was able to survive, fight out of it, reverse him, back and forth. Finally, Barnes gets a rear naked choke of his own and submits Brandon Tierney. I was impressed with both guys. I was kind of hoping both guys could have got a shot to, both guys could have moved forward because I think they're both of them have potential. I've heard a lot about Nick Barnes through War Machine. War Machine talks about him a lot on Twitter. They're teammates, and I've heard about this guy for a while, but I've never actually watched him fight until episode one of the show. So if that was any indication of his skill, I think he's one of the favorites to make it far in the tournament. So he's up there. He's gonna decide who his coach is, and Frank Shamrock gets up there and delivers pretty big speech about how he wants Barnes on his team and how he, loves the guy and how he thinks he can make him a champion. And he really, really wanted the guy on his team, and ultimately Barnes chose him. So that was Frank Shamrock's first fighter. And Greg Jackson and Randy and Joe were kind of giving Frank shit about it, but hey, you got to do what you got to do. If you really want a fighter on your team, that's the way to do it. Frank Shamrock stepped up and got him. Next fight, AJ Matthews beat Darrell Cobb, unanimous decision. It was a fight that was super close, razor sharp. Ended up being a majority draw after two rounds, and they come up with a sudden victory round. Darrell Cobb completely gassed. That's where AJ Matthews completely took over, took the round, took the fight, picked Randy Couture for his team. One thing I gotta note though, which I didn't like very much about how they set this up is it was unrealistic in the sense that they made it look like the selections were even from early on. Like, okay, first guy picks Greg, next guy picks Joe, next guy picks Frank, next guy picks Randy. And that wasn't the way it actually was. I mean, I doubt it. I highly doubt that's the way it turned out, because if this was realistic, and our very own fight scientist, Reed Kuhn, he said the same thing on my Facebook post about the show. He's like, the first four guys will pick Greg Jackson, then everybody else picks Randy, then they pick Frank, and then they pick Joe. I wanted to see that. I wanted to see the real order, like how it actually played out, like who got the most picks early on, who was left kind of in the dark until the end. That wasn't the case. It was just like, oh, let's make it look like it's even Stevens. And I would have won another way, but not a big deal. So AJ Matthews goes to Randy Couture's team. Last fight, you have Chris Lozano beating Josh Quahagan to a pulp, to a decision win. Josh Quahagan's a tough guy. We interviewed him about a year and a half ago on our old radio show, and he was kind of dull. He wasn't the most exciting interview in the world, but he, very passionate about his traditional martial arts background, and we watched a lot of highlights on him, and he's a kind of like a karate-based fighter, but he's pretty damn effective. And Chris Lozano just shut his ass down. But when you look at Chris Lozano, he is a real Bellator veteran. Like, I was actually kind of surprised that they put him on this show, because he's fought guys like Doug Lima, Carl Amasu, he beat Brent Weedman. I mean, he's fought in tournaments. He just doesn't strike me as a guy that's an up-and-comer, but then again, they put Joe Riggs on this show, who's got like over 50 freaking fights and has fought in the UFC and beat Nick Diaz many years ago, and he's on the show. So, I don't really know what they're thinking there, but Lozano's definitely a favorite to make it to the finals. He's clearly the best fighter, at least that was showcased on this episode. We didn't get to see a whole lot of the other guys yet. We'll see that next week, who else is out there, but I would say so far Lozano's an early betting favorite to make it to the finals. And Shamrock had a weird strategy about getting him on his team. He was like, I think you should go to Greg's team. And I don't know why he, said that. Maybe just to trick Lozano into actually picking Frank, and that's what happened. It worked, and ended up getting him. So Shamrock's got probably the two toughest guys right now, and Chris Lozano and this Nick Phoenix kid. So Shamrock's got two guys. Everybody else has one. We'll see how the next episode plays out. But overall, I say the show was pretty good. I'm interested. And I think that's the key. A lot of other people are too. They're interested in this show. They're they're talking about this show, and they want to see what's next. They want to see what's going to happen. How's the show going to progress? Is it going to get better? Is it going to get worse? So that right there, I think, in and itself, is a victory for Bellator, because if people weren't talking about it right now, that's when you say, oh, this show sucks, you know, it's pointless. So we don't really know what to expect yet. I think the format is solid. I like the format. I like the four coaches thing. I like the fact that the fighters pick their coaches. They pick their opponents. It's something fresh. It's something new. My only concern is it can't just be about the coaches. You can't put too much of the focus on them. Of course they're gonna be there to draw in the ratings, because these are some big name guys. I mean, Randy Couture is a huge name, as is Frank Shamrock, as is Greg Jackson. But it shouldn't just be about them and their own egos and them as coaches. It should be more about the fighters on the team and the tournament itself. So hopefully, as the episodes progress, we'll see less of the coaches, you know, being kind of egotistical and more about the focus on the fighters. See how things progress. Now, with that being said, I'm going to try to stop Mercedes Terrell and Jade Bryce from flooding the place right now in this hot tub. So, you guys stay classy, keep on living the dream, and we'll see you on Alchemist Radio this Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, 5 p.m. Mountain Time.
The cult of personality.